हेलो हेलो ओके सो अ वेरी गुड लेट आफ्टरनून
And
ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द
behalf of the internal quality assurance cell, Mr.
And Viswarathi,
Harati, and
in this late afternoon session, today we are coming before you with a very relevant and pertinent topic, that is importance of intellectual property rights for academic institutions. The main title of the webinar is Webinar on Intellectual Property Rights, where our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bidhu Chakraborty, is one of the patron as well as perennial source of this event. And we have speaker to guide us on the topic, and I'm sure their deliberation will give some sort of insights for our future course of academic journey. And today we have with us Professor Rup Kumar Kaur, who is supposed to be the professor department of botany, as well as director IQVC Viswabharati. At the outset, without sparing much time, let me ask our honorable director, Professor Rup Kumar, to deliver his welcome address, as well as always, is busy with some sudden schedule. So may I also request our director, sir, to chair the entire session, as well as to take care for the successful completion of this session. So with these few words from my side, let me directors and of course learned audience, those who have joined and out. So let me now request Professor Rup Kumar Kaur, sir, to deliver his welcome address. Sir, floor is now over. Please take care on this session. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Hello. So, very good afternoon. I have great pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Viswabharati, and also Redi Network to this webinar on intellectual property rights. And the particular theme is the importance of intellectual property rights for academic institutions. Indeed, the issue of IPR is a great concern. For us who are in academia, often we forget about the importance of such IPR in particularly students and faculties among in our universities. Therefore, universities actually are practically the breeding centers for intellectual resources, and these intellectual properties are different from the other properties. It is indivisible and it can be shared by individual persons. So there is a necessity of protection of the ownership. So it should come under legal protection, for India has such intellectual resources no less than other countries. Unfortunately, perhaps we are not aware what other nations have. Even students and faculties associated with a university, particularly general universities like ours, are relatively less concerned about such rights compared to the technical universities, which are practically a major outcome of the patents. So we have often feeling that patents are much more important thing to be protected. But the thing is that we have the intellectual resources which has to be protected at the same time, and it could be a various types of intellectual resources or intellectual properties that we will have some discussion on this day particularly. We'll be enlightened today with the modern concept of IPR and laws and enactments regarding the protection of IPR, particularly in connection with the academic institutions. We are fortunate to have among us Dr. Pratibha Singh, Deputy Advisor, NAC, New Delhi, who will deliver the inaugural address. Thank you, Dr. Singh, for accepting our invitation. I welcome you to this virtual arena of Vishwa Bharati, blessed with the ideas of Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. I also welcome Dr. Ashwini Sewal, Associate Professor in IP and IT Law, Faculty of Law, University of Delhi, and also Director, LC2 Entrepreneurial Law Clinic. So his deliberation will enrich, enlighten, and benefit us immensely. And thank you, Dr. Sewal, for accepting our invitation and giving us the opportunity to listen to you. So with these few words, I would request Dr. Pratibha Singh to start her deliberation in connection with the inaugural speech. Dr. Pratibha Singh, please.
Yes. Good evening to all the participants present here, Honorable Vice Chancellor and the delegates and the various speakers who have joined for today's. I hope my voice is reaching, sir. So I welcome each one of you for this today's very relevant topic of how to protect the intellectual property of various academics, and also the relevant information related to filing of the patents, and also what is the process and procedures that are available, and what are the resources available to various faculty members for various academics in order to protect their intellectual property. So the details will be covered by the speakers, and I would now take some information. I would like to give some information related to the higher education sector and the quality assurance mechanism, and how these things are related to the various quality parameters in which the intellectual property rights and the patent filing, etc., is one of the parameters for the assessment and accreditation. Respected all the academicians of the Vishwa Bharati University, as you know, that new education policy has already been launched, and we are on the daily basis going through some kind of interaction and the orientation sessions for the implementation of this policy. And you may be knowing that the entire system of higher education, which was reported under this policy, has been defined as completely fragmented system, in which the individual institutions and the universities were reported to be kind of a single discipline offering some kind of specific specializations. And often the higher education statistics, which was reported in the Aisha report, also tells us that there are so many institutions for which the enrollment of the students is very less. You may be knowing that around 16 to 17% of the colleges are there for which the enrollment is less than 100, and only 4% institutions are there in the country for which the enrollment is more than 3000. So the situation is very critical. Only 4% institutions where the enrollment is around 3000 plus is a kind of alarming situation. And what the other institutions will be doing, and how they will be transforming in the coming days. So NAC is an autonomous body of University Grants Commission, which was established in the year 1994. And the mandate of NAC is to do the assessment and accreditation of higher education institutions of the country. And basically, we develop the parameters and the framework for the assessment and accreditation. And this framework which we develop, it is not a constant framework. It keeps on changing based on the changing scenario of the higher education sector of the country. So you may be knowing that NAC takes the institutional accreditation, whereas other agencies like NBA does the program accreditation. So in this process of assessment and accreditation, the present framework which we are having is a revised accreditation framework, in which one of the components of the revised accreditation framework or the parameters is for the university, we have around 20%, 25% weightage given to research, in which various research awards, various publications in the various international and national journals, and also in this Corpus Web of Science and India Citation Index, the journals listing is encouraged. And also the incubation and startup activities which the university or the institution is carrying out, and what is the participation level of the faculty members in those specific areas, and how do you encourage the innovation for the faculty members and for the students. Some of the parameters we have kept in the various frameworks of the institutions, which includes the universities and colleges. So this revised accreditation framework is talking about the research component, and in which this the IPR related thing is also present. I hope you have seen, you must have seen this manual, which is available on NAC website. And not only NAC, various other quality assurance mechanisms of the country, such as National Institution Ranking Framework, also talks about the patent, how many patents filed and granted, and also licensed, and what is the income generated out of it. So I'm sure that all those things will be covered in today's webinar session, and the faculty members and the participant would be benefited from the excellent deliberations which the speakers are going to talk about in the succeeding sessions. So coming back to the quality assurance mechanism of the country, so you might have came to know as of now that revised accreditation framework, which we are doing, the entire accreditation framework is also subjected to now going to change as per the NEP guidelines. And we will be having a National Accreditation Council, and which will be basically a monitoring body, in which the frameworks will be set based on the basic norms, public self-disclosure, good governance and outcome. And there will be multiple accreditation agencies that has been spelled out in the National Education Policy, and those accreditation bodies will be doing the accreditation, and NAC would be a kind of ecosystem developing the framework for the assessment and accreditation, and maybe giving the licenses to multiple accreditation agencies. So this is the change which we are expecting in the coming days as per the implementation of National Education Policy. And I hope that the things will be more fruitful in coming days, because the country is now suffering from the low quality of the higher education institutions, and only about 20 to 30% institutions have gone for the assessment and accreditation. So the rate why the institutions are not moving ahead, and the reasons and the key components for this low grade of quality has also been identified in the National Education Policy, and the resources has resources also basically have been tried to be increased from the in terms of GDP. There is a specific recommendation that the expenditure should be at least 6% increased, and that we will be able to see when we are implementing this policy. So that is all from my side. I believe this particular workshop will be definitely giving good insights about the how to file patents, how to file, what are the differences between patents, copyrights, trademarks, and all those things, and what are the various databases which are been there at the national level and at the international levels, and how to search, and how, what is the timelines for doing this patenting, and all those things will be covered in this today's sessions. And I hope that this particular deliberations and discussions will be fruitful to all the participants. And I thank the organizers for giving me opportunity to address this gathering, and hope that this workshop will be definitely successful. And thank you very much. And thank you very much for giving me opportunity. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Over to you, sir. That's all for my side. That is what yes, I can sorry. Say this in this yeah. moment.
So thank you very much, Dr. Singh, for your kind inaugural speech and also just a briefing of the topic. Just listen to Dr. Siwal, who is, has the expertise on these particularly enactments in the, regard to the protection of the IPR. So Dr. Siwal, please, I'm handing over to mic to you, please.
Yes, very good afternoon, late good afternoon to one and all whosoever has joined for this 1.5 hour interaction on a very pertinent issue. As you know, emphasized by Dr. Pratibha Singh, that this is something which is very important, especially in the times when we have a very low quality work coming from the institutions. And, you know, we have very low quality higher education institutions, you know, mushrooming in the country. We certainly have IPR regimen to cater to this aspect or to address this, you know, concern of her, which she raised. Apart from that, you know, IPR as such is very important for the university system, because whatever we produce in the universities, it has some sort of recognition, not only academically, rather it is important monetarily as well as, you see, in terms of raising the standards of the higher education in the country. So there are several issues which are hampering our universities, our higher education institutions to excel, which I would highlight during the course of this interaction with the audience. But before I proceed ahead with those things, at the outset, I would like to thank or extend my gratitude to the Vishwa Bharati fraternity for inviting me here for this particular session and webinar. I take opportunity to thank in absentia the Honorable Vice Chancellor of the university. I also take the opportunity to thank Professor Roop Kumar Kar, who gave the welcome address for this particular webinar. And I also would like to thank Dr. Sanyal. She had roped me in for this particular webinar. So with this small note, you see, I would start giving the presentation, wherein the scheme would be to introduce the audience with the kinds of intellectual properties that we have, then the respective legislations in relation to those intellectual properties. And I would then zero into the specific IPs, which are most important from the university point of view, from the academic institution's point of view. I mean to say that I would specifically zero into copyright and the patent. There are other intellectual properties also, which are, of course, important. But these are the two which I would gonna cover in this session, because we don't have much time to cover all, and especially the aspects or the components that Dr. Pratibha Singh highlighted. She pitched on two important aspects in her inaugural address. She raised the point of proprietorship and ownership of those things, and then different subject matters pertaining to those, the proprietary issues, the ownership issues, and the legislative issues which we face. Right. So with this, cursory note in the beginning, I would like to share the screen with the audience. Now I have been allowed to share my screen. I'm going to share the screen. Let me see. Share file. Microsoft. 1 minute. Is it visible to the audience? Is screen yes. visible to the audience?
Yes.
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 Okay. Right. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for facilitating me. Sharing. So let's see, why do we need intellectual property? I really don't need to tell what does intellectual property mean. Still, for those who does not even know what does it mean, I have put certain common parlance terms here. I mean, intellectual properties are the properties which are the offshoots of our minds, or you may say which are creations of our mind. We at times create some literary works, artistic work, dramatic works, certain inventions we do create, and scientific inventions I'm talking about, and so on and so forth. There is a long list that get covered under the IP regimen or under the intellectual property framework. We have a very robust intellectual framework in the country on on the works which we create, and this framework helps us in recognition, in giving the recognition or in recognizing our works, first of all, except or, you know, with subject to certain conditions, of course. I mean, we need to qualify, first of all, to get the protections offered by the intellectual property regimen or the intellectual property ecosystem. And then the same ecosystem helps us enforcing our works in case of infringements, if any infringement or a violation of our work takes place. So I have listed out, you know, these are the creations of the mind. It may be any manifestation of your mind. It may be a creative writing. It may be a creative painting. It may be a creative cinematograph work. It may be a creative photography. It may be a creative, you see, or a novel invention or a process or a product created by you. And then we have a whole list or range of things. In the trademark regimen, we have marks, logos, symbols, word, letter, numerals, which are getting the protection under the system. So there are several things which may be protected under the intellectual property regimen. Say chemical formulas, computer programs, images, logos, designs, performances, cinefilms, music compositions, etc. So these are some of the things, illustrative things I have jotted down in the presentation. I don't have the exhaustive list because there can never be an exhaustive list. Even in our legislations, if I refer to trademark law, for example, there does not lie a, you know, exhaustive list what all can be given a trademark protection. The word mark has been defined, or a trademark has been defined, which is an inclusive definition, which includes so many things. And there is a scope of inclusion of newer things also, or the novel things also. So this list can never be exhaustive. The prerequisite for obtaining the intellectual property is the work has to be, or the, you may say, creative work has to be offshoot of your mind. You claim that you have created it. It must qualify the prerequisites for obtaining the protection. If it is a work which is a subject matter of the patent law, then it certainly needs to be novel, non-obvious, and of utility. If it is a work which is copyrightable, then it has to have originality in it, or the requisite originality in it. If it is a trademark, then it must have a distinctiveness, or the feature of distinctiveness involved in it, so on and so forth, like that. I mean, there are certain qualifications which are legislatively required qualifications, which are to be met necessarily. Only then you proceed ahead with the, you know, enjoying or exploiting your work monetarily or for, you know, other purposes. So these are the works, you know, which may get the, you know, protection under the intellectual property regimen. Now the question arises, why do we need actually, you know, this intellectual property regimen? So I have few points to tell at the outset. We certainly need the intellectual property regimen because it actually strikes a balance between the public and the private rights. The individual who creates a work, he certainly applies certain labor, some capital, some expenditure is involved. And so, you know, a lot of hard work is involved. Everything does not come out of serendipity. There are rare occasions when some works are, you know, created or get created serendipitously. But most of the times, especially in today's world, where the world is very competitive, where you see individual creators, they are always aspiring to create new works. So they certainly seek exclusive rights over their works. A sort of monopoly has to be given to them. So the laws are required, or the intellectual property regimen, or the recognition in the form of property of this work is necessary to create a balance between the private and the public rights. Because the private individual, or the individual who has created the work, he has an exclusive monopoly for a certain period of time, which is limited in terms of time and space. He does not have the monopoly, which is an absolute kind of a monopoly. His monopoly also ceases after a certain point of time. In the case of patents, it ceases after 20 years. In the case of copyright, it ceases after the lifetime, 60 more years. It remains with the heirs of the copyright owner. But after that, it ceases. So that's like that. You know, it's like, you know, a monopoly, which is temporospatial monopoly, limited in terms of time and space. It has a territorial application also. If you have filed a patent exclusively in one country, your patent will be operative in one country. It does not go beyond the borders of that particular country. And it has a economic significance. We all understand it now. There's no denial or there can never be a doubt that IP boosts economy. It also facilitates economic growth of the nation. We have many instances of the countries like Japan and now China. You see, they are excelling like anything because of their technological innovations, because of their intellectual property ecosystem, because of their intellectual property portfolio. We as a nation also doing very good. I'm not saying that we are lagging far behind them. But there is scope of improvement in our country, and we are improving gradually. But if we compare with the other nations, then I say that our pace in terms of reaping the benefits of intellectual property regimen and its ecosystem is little skewed if we compare vis-a-vis to nations like Japan and China, right? These are the countries, especially Japan, had progressed after a chaotic background or the history. Still, they excelled like anything because they had very excellent intellectual property recognition systems in place, very strong and robust infrastructure and ecosystem was there in place. Like, we also are improving and, aspiring towards that kind of a system. Then we have another reason for having this intellectual property regimen. That it caters to several industries. It caters to IT industry, entertainment industry, manufacturing industry, pharma sector. And if you see the academic institutions in the country, all these sectors have some bearing with our academic institutions, be it entertainment, be it manufacturing, be it pharma, or IT for that matter. Universities are not running aloof or in isolation. They have collaborations with the industry. They have collaboration with the public organizations. So we can't say that we run in silos. We have to necessarily collaborate with the industry and public organizations. And during our collaboration, sometimes IPs are licensed, assigned, or IPs are shared, intellectual properties are shared. So we have to be very systematic and careful as to how to go ahead with our IP sharing, especially the IPs created under the aegis of the university or under the premises of the university by utilizing the resources of the university. There has to be policies in place of the intellectual property handling and intellectual property enforcement of the universities. We have legislations, there's no doubt about it, but those legislations are general legislations. We as academic institutions are free to have our own policies dealing with the intellectual properties created under the universities. But those must be in parlance, or you may say those must be certainly in sync with the legislative framework of the country. We can't flout those legislative frameworks that are there in the country or which are in place in the country. So we certainly need intellectual property regimen. There is no doubt about it. I am proceeding ahead. It is lucrative. It is a key business asset. We need IP for market goods and services. It spurs economic growth. It incentivizes the creator. It gives a recognition and fame to the creators of the work. So these are some of the, this is not an exhaustive, again, I say, exhaustive list of the factors benefits of having an intellectual property system, but few intellectual property factors or you may say the components indicative of what that we certainly need an intellectual property regimen. Then if I come to the legislation part or the framework that we have in the country, I have broadly listed the major intellectual property legislations which are catering to different sort of kinds of works or sort of works. We have a Copyright Act of 1956, we have Patents Act 1970, we have Trademarks Act 1999, we have Designs Act 2000, we have GIs Act 1999, we have Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers Rights Act 2001. And lastly, we have a Semiconductor Integrated Circuits Layout Designs Act of year 2000. So these are the acts I have reproduced here on the screen to make you understand that our legislative framework is quite robust and it is adequate enough to cater to the needs of the intellectual property creators and to look after the nuanced issues involved in the intellectual property management and its valuation too. But let me tell you, frankly, you see, as per the international instrument, which is the most comprehensive international instrument in this regard, which is TRIPS, Agreement on Trade-Related Aspects of Intellectual Property. One of the major, kind of intellectual property recognized in the TRIPS has not been implemented in our country, that is undisclosed information. So we don't have any legislation on undisclosed information, but we have, segmental regulations, we have contractual arrangements, we have other legislative measures available to cater to the aspect of undisclosed information. But those are not adequate. We certainly need to recognize that aspect also, which is mandated by the TRIPS. But somehow, that has been missed by our legislature. But we, as I said, that in a country have framework which caters to those aspects directly through certain contractual arrangements or sometimes through other laws or some other measures. But broadly speaking, these are the legislations which we have in place, which have been amended periodically and gradually, which have other corresponding rules also to make these, empowered or to reinforce the existing legislative framework in the country. Then moving ahead to, certain examples to make you understand what are the different kinds of intellectual property, we have and what are their examples? Say, what all can be protected under the copyright law? What all can be protected under the trademark law? What all can be protected under the patent law? And so on and so forth. So I have put some examples of the following intellectual properties, right? Starting with the patents. As I said, that patents are protecting products and processes. And these products and processes has to be necessarily new. Or you may say, legislatively speaking or technically speaking, the law confers a protection, the patent law, the Patent Act 1970, it confers a protection on new inventions, basically. And the word new invention has been defined as what? Any product or any new product or process which involves an inventive step and capable of industrial application. That is the verbatim definition provided over there under Section 2 of the Indian Patents Act 1970, which reads that any new invention, which means a product or a process, can be given a patent protection if it involves an inventive step and if it is capable of industrial application. So any work that is going on in our academic institutions, in the laboratories, right, we see lot of innovations, or you may say, loosely I'm using the word innovations, but the Patent Act 1970 nowhere uses the word innovation. It uses the word new invention, right? Because the list of certain things which are not inventions has been given under the Patent Act 1970 by purview of Section 3. So we have a negative list, under the Patents Act 1970, which says that these works will never be called an invention. Rest of the things will automatically be called inventions for the purposes of patenting in country. Subject to what? Subject to the requirement of novelty, non-obviousness, and utility. The work has to be new, novel. Then there has to be a non-obviousness, or you may say, as said in the legislation, that the work must be, must have inventive step in it. It must not be obvious to the person who is skilled in that art. It has to be non-obvious to that person who is skilled in that art. Say a chemistry person is working in the laboratory, and if something is obvious to him, if he can come out with the same kind of output or offshoot, which one claimant or which one applicant of the patent application claiming the patent protection on that particular work has come out with, then that chemistry professor or the chemistry scholar or the researcher may say that it is an obvious work. It is not a non-obvious work. And a non-obviousness is one of the sine qua non for getting the patent protection on any product or process. And similarly, we have another requirement of industrial application of your work. If there is no industrial application in your work, no matter how creative your work is or how novel your work is, no matter how non-obvious your work is, there has to be an industrial application of your work as per the requirements of the Patents Act. Only then you can get the patent protection. So this is a cursory introduction about the patent or the scheme of the patent or the subject matter of the patent. Then I refer to certain examples, say an example of a product patent here, we have a product of which is a sports equipment. It's an old patent given in 1973, right? This is a newest sport at that point in time, where this patent was registered on a snowboard, basically. Then we have another example. This is the specification of the snowboard. See, mind it that when you apply for the patent protection, you have to give the complete specification of your work after some time. In the beginning, you may give the provisional specification. After that, you get the 12 months time to give the complete specification like this. I mean, if it is a product, then you have to describe the product in this technical manner, that it has got several components, it has got so much of utility, it has got so many advancements over the existing snowboards, etc., etc. Only then you apply for the patent application, which might get the patent protection subject to involving all qualifications in it and not getting hit by any of the disqualifications. Then I have put one more example. This is a resurfacing machine, ice resurfacing machine, basically. It is also an old patent of 1953. So things like that, I mean, you may search several kinds of patents and, products or processes, their specimens on the open access on the Google or anywhere, I mean, wherever you want to find, on any internet platform you want to find. So these are some examples to make you understand that you have to specify in a detailed manner what are the advances in your work. Then we have some examples of the processes, like a dry powder composition for a process of making a pharmaceutical composition, for example, a novel process for the manufacture of pore and doped bivalent metal sulfide nanopowders. These are some examples of processes where you can get the patent protection. So, but again, I say that patent is a very strenuous or a stringent procedure. We have to be very careful at every stage. If I start speaking on the patent procedure and patent niceties or the patentability niceties, it will take a whole load of time, and I won't be able to cover in that time. So I have just put some cursory examples to make the audience understand that products and processes are patentable. Even product by processes are also patentable in the Indian patent system. And we became the product patent regime in 2005. Prior to that, we were only process patent regime. Since we are the TRIPS compliant or a TRIPS signatory nation, so in 1995, we ratified the TRIPS. After that, we were given a transition period of 10 years to bring changes into our domestic framework or the domestic legislation. And that took 10 years for us because we had the 10 years of time period with us, which is called a transition period. During the 10 years, we saw what are the requirements of our nation and how to cope up with those requirements. In 2005, we became the product patent regime, and now we are a product patent regime at par with other nations. So we recognize conferring patent protections on even end products. A drug is there which has been created by A plus B plus C process, and the outcome is D called drug. I mean, that D is also patentable, as well as the A plus B plus C is patentable here. The process as well as the end product, both are patentable now as per the Patents Act 1970. Now I jump to another example, or you may say that example for other kinds of intellectual properties. We have an example of a trademark. Here there are logos, several logos are there in the picture. So these are all trademarks. Then these are again logos, these are also trademarks, right? So I have put many such things here which may not be visible, but we see every day in our common walk of life. These things used, these logos, words, symbol, letter, numerals used, or combination of such things used in the course of trade. So trademarks are basically in the course of trade. And we see these things in the course of trade, which are protected under the Trademarks Act, basically. Now, let me give you examples of the copyright, basically. Photographs, paintings, right? And literary works, like a book or a poem or any sort of a literary work penned down by you. It may be in the form of a book or an article or a research paper or whatever. Sculptures, sound recordings, all these things are copyrightable. We get the copyright protection on these things because these are the subject matters of the copyright. The copyright law, by purview of section 13, reads that original literary artistic works are copyrightable under the Copyright Act. And it also reads that cinematograph works, sound recording, etc. are also copyrightable. And these, broad works entail many things or encompass many other small subject matters in it, or you may call species under it. Like, in the case of literary works, we have a definition of literary works in the copyright law, which entails in it the computer programs, right? Which is a different or a unique system or a framework in the country. In rest of the world, or in certain parts of the world, we see that computer programs and softwares are patentable. But here in India, the computer programs and computer databases are copyrightable because they are falling under the category of literary works. They don't fall under the category of patentable subject matters. They fall under the category of copyrightable subject matters through literary works. Similarly, there are other works which entail or encompass many small works, right? Photographs, literary artistic work, dramatic works, paintings, sculpture, sound recording, cine films, and so on and so forth. So the list is long where the copyright protection can be conferred. I have jotted here the illustrative examples to make you understand that copyright can be conferred on these things. But the important point is copyright can be conferred only when the works are original. Original in the copyright means, the law does not define what does original mean, but the judge-made law, or you may say the jurisprudence on that aspect, gives us the clear understanding, or you may say the fair understanding, what does, you see, original mean. For the purposes of the copyright, original mean that the work must originate from the author of that work, and it must not be a substantial copy of someone else's work. Or you may say there has to be a minimal creativity in your work. If there does not lie a minimal creativity in your work will not be called original for the purposes of the copyright, and you may not get the copyright protection. Another interesting fact about the copyright regime is that copyright is an automatic protection regime. We don't need to really apply to the copyright office for getting the copyright protection. The moment you create the work, you get the copyright protection over your work, notwithstanding that you had rushed to the copyright office and have formally or duly registered it. There's no need of registering it duly because we are a signatory of the Berne Convention. The country is a signatory of a Berne Convention. The Berne Convention lays down that copyrights are automatic protection regime, or copyrights should be automatic protection regimes across all nations, across all signatory nations. So when we create a work, if it is a subject matter of the copyright and if it is original, if it involves the the minimal or modicum of creativity in it, originality in it, we get the protection automatically, outrightly. You don't need to formally get it registered. If you want to do so, you may do so because it's optional, and you may do so anytime. It's up to you. It's not going to make any change except an evidentiary value that it may have. A certificate that you purchase will have an evidentiary value. Otherwise, if you had created the work and it is original, you can anytime claim that it is your copyrightable work and you have a copyright on it, and you can enforce it also in case of an infringement. I'll pick up certain important issues from the academic point of view later. Let me complete the examples of several kinds of IPs. Performances are also copyrightable. Cine films are also copyrightable, right? Then we have examples of geographical indications. I told you that we have seven legislations catering to intellectual property in India, and GIs is one such legislation, or Geographical Indications Act is one such legislation. We rarely see application of GIs in somebody's requesting to annotate the shared content. What does it mean? Why somebody is requesting the annotation? I have declined that request. So I'm coming back to that point which I'm making, that GI does not have much application in the university system. But still, we need to know, I mean, briefly, I mean, we need to know what does GI mean and on what different subjects GI protections are given. So GIs can be given on manufactured goods, on agricultural goods. Broadly, there are some examples which I have listed here. Like, you know, we have GI on Darjeeling tea. We don't have a GI on Meerut Caesar. Forget about, or, you know, forget me for this wrong information put on the screen. Meerut Caesars were applied for a GI, but they were not able to successfully get the GI protection. But on other things listed here, we have a GI protection available. But broadly speaking, GI protection is available on agricultural goods, on manufactured goods. But another important factor of the GI protection is that GIs are given to the community, unlike other intellectual properties which are given to individuals. So GI basically facilitates communities. Like we have Darjeeling tea. Darjeeling tea geographical indication is not owned by one individual or one family. It is owned by the community, which is engaged in cultivation or farming of the Darjeeling tea, which has its own aroma and unique taste because of the climatic conditions, because of the soil conditions and demographic conditions of that locality. So you can understand quickly that GIs are given only to agricultural and manufactured goods and food products which are produced by the community, which have some features in it attributable to the climatic conditions, soil, or some skill set of the people. In the case of, say, silk sarees, right, or Kanjivaram silk, for example, the skill set of the people is such which creates these works, and so on and so forth. Right. So we have few more examples. I'm rushing because we don't have time. These are the industrial designs. The industrial design protection on is protection. The protection is available on the designs. Basically, it may be a design of a chair. It may be a design of a table. It may be a design of a bottle. It may be a design of a t-shirt or apparel design for that matter, or a design of a shoe. It's again, catering to a design industry a lot. And industrial design protection is available for 15 years maximum, initially for 10 years, then extendable to another 5 years by renewal. So maximum protection in the case of designs is 15 years. Then now I'm coming to this portion where the importance of the intellectual properties for the academic institutions, it is discussed. As I said in the beginning, that universities are the platforms where you see a lot of intellectual property is created. Now, those who had heard me patiently, though I have been speaking very fast because of the purpose, and the purpose is that I want to focus on this aspect. Let me tell you that, these two intellectual properties which I have here, filter for you, are really, really very important for the academic institutions, especially the patents, as mentioned by Dr. Pratibha Singh, Deputy Advisor NEC. She highlighted the very important point that during the NAC accreditation, it is seen how many patents the university has filed, how many patents have been granted in favor of the university, how many patents are in process of getting the patent protection. And even in accrediting, or valuing the credentials of any of the aspirants for, say, university appointments, for university selections, or for that matter for scholarships, etc. These things are taken into consideration. How many patents this individual own, or this candidate own, how many patents are created by the university in giving the accreditations to the university. But why I am concerned and why I am so worried about this part. Because in the university system, I am not talking about the top 100 universities of the country, or not talking about the major universities of the country. I am talking about those higher education institutions and the universities in the country where there is no culture of creating works, be it a patentable work or copyrightable work for that matter. There are several such universities where copying is rampant, where patent products or processes are not created. Lot of resources are there, but still the people are not involved in creating the work. And at times it is found, I have visited personally many such institutions where people are they are not aware at all. I know about Vishwabharati. You know, this is a educational hub of intellectuals where, you know, we have a lot of excellent colleagues creating good work. But I'm talking about those institutions where there are good colleagues, but because they don't have the information or the awareness about these aspects, they really don't seek the protection. They know that there's something called patent, but they are clueless about filing the patent. They're clueless about the timings, when to file the patent, how to file, where to file, right? These are some crucial questions or the critical questions which hamper them or the university in filing the patent protection. Similarly, in the case of the copyright, we see that the degradation is taking place in the universities, especially in the scholarly works that are being submitted to the universities. Though we have a requirement by the UGC of plagiarism check and similarity check, but those measures are also inadequate. I'll pinpoint what are the shortcomings of those measures in the discussions here. Let me come to the patent part first, and then I'll go to the copyright first, where I will discuss one case study also of the Delhi University to make the library people understand how important copyright is, and for the university purposes, how can we use copyrightable work to educate the masses, especially in our poor country or in the public institutions or in the central universities. Patents ki agar baat kare to, we have the problem in recognizing the patentable work. First and the foremost issue is that the people working in the laboratories, they don't recognize that the work created by them, by investing labor, by investing expenditure, by investing time and energies, are something which can be given protection under the patent system in India. Products and processes are patentable, as I said in the beginning, at the outset. So there that recognition needs to be there, or education has to be there among the people or the researcher, that the work that they are doing can get the patent protection. And simultaneously, I pick up important aspect here, the in vitro works that are being done or in process of being done at this juncture. Whatever information you jot down in your notebook or whatever record that you keep, those records are copyrightable, mind it. You must also seek copyright protection on those parts. Even before publishing those works or even before filing for patent on those works, you have a copyright on those data entries made by you or database created by you during the course of your research. Say a research continued for long 5 years, you kept on keeping the record of the informations with you relating to that particular research. So that has a copyright protection, and it comes automatically. As I said in the beginning, copyright is an automatic protection. If you find someone misusing it, substantially copying it, or using it without acknowledgement or due acknowledgement, then in that case, mind it that it is a copyright infringement. He or she is violating your copyright protection. We have a patent available on the outcome or on the process of producing a work, no doubts about it. But the patent process may take several years in conferring you a protection. And it might fail also, because the patent search which is conducted at the end of the patent office is a global search. Though the patent protection is conferred to you in the territorial segment, or you may say in the territorial manner, only to your country your patent applies, unless you have filed the international patent application wherein you have sought a protection in other nations also. But primarily you get the patent protection in your country because it is a territorial in scope. But the global search is conducted while conferring a patent to you. So mind it that you need to recognize that your work is such which may be a protectable work under the patent regime. Then what is the protection available? I said at the outset that 20 years protection or the term of the patent is available to the creator of the product or the process if it is found novel, non-obvious, and of utility. And novelty is seen on the basis of prior art search, or you may say the search is conducted at the end of the patent office, which is called prior art search or a patent search. So if there is found any prior art globally resembling your work, then your claim will fail. You won't succeed in getting the patent protection. But if there is no single prior art resembling your work, then in that case, you stand a chance of getting the patent protection subject to the fulfillment of the other qualifications of obtaining the patent. But that is how the novelty of the patent is gauged, or newness in the patent is gauged. So protection is available for 20 years. We have 4 patent offices in the country catering to the territorial parts, or you may say the geographical parts of the country. We have in Delhi, we have in Calcutta, we have in Bombay and Ahmedabad, right? Four different locations are there where the patent offices are situated, and these 4 are catering to the different parts of the country. So you have to see where your jurisdiction lies, or where can you apply for the patent protection. And if you think that your work is such which is worthy of getting a patent protection, or is eligible for getting a patent protection, you must not think any other thing except then filing the patent application, because you get a priority over other competitors. If you file first, you get the priority over other competitors because you are first to file. And you have to be first to file if you seek the priority over others. If you fail to file it on time, or you may say on a priority basis, you may gonna lose it. If your work is ready to an extent where you can explain provisionally that this is your work which will take this shape after some time, if your work is ready in such manner where you think that within span of 12 months you will be ready with the entire work or the complete work with the complete specification, you must not hesitate then to file the patent application expeditiously to the patent office without waiting. So protection is available. How to avail that protection, how to go ahead with the patent filing, the procedure, etc., needs to be understood by all the researchers. For that, you certainly need a technical session, which I am ready to offer. But in today's discussion, I am focusing more on the IP and its importance from the academic institution's point of view. I'm not focusing exclusively on the procedure for patent and its filing. That requires a separate session. Then filing, I have highlighted that universities should facilitate the filing, and we have the the cluster innovation centers in the universities. We have patent filing facilitating centers in the universities. All universities perhaps have these kind of measures and centers available within the universities, except or barring few universities where these kinds of centers have not been established by the universities themselves. But most of the universities have these kind of centers and establishments which facilitate the innovators or the inventors to file the patent applications. And mind it, when you go through this route of filing the patent application through these establishments of the universities, you don't need to bear much cost, because the cost is at times shared by the university or exclusively borne by the university, because it is the university patent which is being filed by the university for you, right? You may become a co-inventor with the university, but most of the time, if the university IP policy is such where the university will become the patent owner of the work created by you, then the university will own the patent, right? You may be the beneficiary in certain aspects according to the contractual arrangement or policy arrangement of the university available in your university, but most of the universities are keeping the patents or the intellectual properties with them. They don't allow the patent inventors to keep the patents available only exclusively to the inventors, because the resources of the university, the public resources of the universities, are used by the innovators and the inventors. This is again one interesting thing which I would like to emphasize at this juncture. We see that a lot of innovators and inventors, they use the public resources and the resources of the university and file the patent applications on their own names. If the university does not have any policy to hemp, to obstruct you or to stop you, you may go ahead with filing it on your own name. But if the university has a policy in place which requires you to file the patent application through the university and it will be owned by the university, then university will keep, or academic institution will keep, the patent with it. You will not be allowed to file it on your own or singly, you may say, because it's the policy which determines the fate of the ownership in the cases of the universities. Then enforcement is the another aspect or another concern. We see at times the patent subject matters are created in the universities which are sometimes stolen, or data are being extracted, copied, or you may say some information is being taken away by other researchers, by scholars. Sometimes the scholars are creating the work, and the supervisors are insisting on the co-authorship or co-ownership on the patents, which is unethical, completely unethical, unless you had, you know, contributed, or you have been contributing, or you had played an immense role in creating the work. You may seek a patent, co-ownership. Otherwise, being a supervisor alone does not give you any qualification to become a co-owner of the patent protection, because the law is clear about it. Law says that the true and first inventor will be given the patent application, or he himself can file the patent application. This is the verbatim words used in the Indian Patent Act: true and first inventor. So if the research scholar is the true and first inventor, then he will get the patent protection, not the supervisor. But if both had done something together, had contributed together, had invested time, capital, money, energies, etc. together, then they both can become the patent owners. But if the university resources have been used, and the policy is categorically saying that the university will keep the patent protection to itself, then the university will become the owner. The individuals will not gonna be the owners of those patents. Mind it, in the Western world, the patent are owned generally by the researchers on their own names, and public resources are used, which is problematic, which has been always debatable, and it is still debatable. But certain universities has now come up with the categorical policy or explicit policy, which requires that the universities will become the owners, not the researchers or the inventors. And if the inventors had bargained with the universities that they are ready to work in the university, and they require the ownership simultaneously, then in that case, that bargaining works. I mean, the contractual arrangement, if the contrary contractual arrangement is available, then that works perfectly fine. But if there is no contractual contrary contractual arrangement available, and there is only university policy which requires the inventors or the innovators to give the ownership to the university, then the university will own the patent on it. Then there comes the licensing aspect, which is very problematic, especially with the university system. As I said in the beginning, that universities don't operate in silos or in isolation. They always collaborate with the public organizations. They always collaborate for funding, etc., with the industries. And the research, we get the funding, etc., that is perfectly fine. Where does the problem arise? The problem arises when the work is ready, it has been filed, the patent has been granted, and there arises an issue of licensing, or there comes a time when the work is to be licensed. In the collaborations especially, licenses are done, right? Because ultimately, what is the fate of your work? It has to be exploited monetarily. Be it a university's work, it has to be exploited monetarily, and its benefits should be trickled or percolated to the masses, right? And it can't be done if it is not industrially applied. So for industrial application, you need to collaborate with the industry, wherein you license your work to the industry or to the public organization, right? That licensing needs to be very careful. If you do that licensing, you have to be very careful. Somebody is writing, let me see what's going on. There are some people who are writing or maybe asking questions. But since I have made my screen available and I'm having a full screen available for view in front of me, I'm not getting the questions on my screen. One moment.
We can go for the question session later at the end of this lecture. Okay.
Right, sir. Still, those are not visible. Leave it. So the point is, licensing is one part which is very, really very important and has to be taken care of very smartly. During licensing your work to the industry with whom you collaborated, or take help of the public body or the organization for funding, etc., of your work, but you had not come or not chalked out the clear terms of ownership, etc., in relation to your work in the beginning. And then you all of a sudden face the problem because they say that we had funded it and we need the ownership, right? Or it may happen that no clear terms were chalked out in the beginning, and later on the private body or the industry with whom you collaborated is asking for the patent protection or the ownership on the patent because they had funded it. Mind it, you know, they might have funded it, they might have done, you know, support, extended support to you. But since the work has been created by you, you own the patent, it has been filed by you on the patent. So either, you know, you get bargaining done very clearly in the very beginning when you enter into such collaboration. If you had not done it in the beginning, then in that case, you know, at the time of licensing of your work to them, you have to be careful because there are two kinds of licensing that are taking place nowadays. One is exclusive licensing or one is non-exclusive licensing. So if you give an exclusive license to them, then they exclusively will be the entity who will be monetizing it, who will be, you know, industry applying it. So you have to be careful. If there are no terms written or thought out in the beginning, at this juncture when you had created the work and had conferred a patent protection, which has been conferred a patent protection, I mean, you own a patent, you have to be careful that which kind of a patent you want to go with in the licensing. You may, ideally, you may choose for the non-exclusive licensing because it is always open for you then to license it to other bodies also. If you are disappointed with the earlier body or the collaborator, then in that case, you know, if you have a non-exclusive license with them, you may go ahead with licensing to other entities also. It is no, you know, it is limitless. I mean, it's up to you to with whom or with how many agencies or bodies you want to license your work with. It's up to, you know, worthiness of your work or worthiness of your work. If they seek the license of your work, you may go ahead. But if you had done an exclusive licensing with one entity, they will stop you from licensing it further. So mind it, you must not enter into an exclusive license unless at the time of the funding in the initial period, you had agreed for the exclusive license if the work will get created and if the work will fetch the patent protection. Then there are other things also which are important. During the licensing, you know, at times some undisclosed information or you may say the trade secrets are also licensed. But those are not licensed through the patent regime. Those are licensed through the confidentiality regime, or you may say those are licensed through some other manner, or you may say some common law systems are there in place. There is no law which you know, facilitates you in licensing of those aspects. But we have arrangements like, you know, non-disclosure agreements are done. If you have some information which you do not want to license to the entities as what? As patents. Rather, you want to license those as secrets, you may do so. It's up to you. It's your choice. But if you want to license it as a patent, and if it is a patentable subject matter over which you have a sort of patent protection, you must license it as a patent. So it's up to you or your choice by which methodology you want to go. So these are the concerns which I think are there in the university system as far as the patents are concerned. Inter alia, there are other you know, issues also. Then coming to the copyright aspect or copyright part, we have a major problem in the copyright. First and the foremost is the production of your work. As I said, that automatic protection is available. So automatic protection means you create the work, you get the protection. There's no requirement of the filing, as I said in the beginning. When it comes to enforcement, as I said in the beginning, that enforcement measures are there under the Copyright Act 1957. Criminal remedies are also there. In the patent law, there are no criminal remedies, only civil remedies are available. But in the Copyright Act, we have criminal remedies. If somebody is found copying your work and has been convicted for what? Has been convicted for copyright violation of your work, he may be held liable criminally, wherein he may go for the imprisonment or have to serve the imprisonment or a jail. Then we have ownership issue in the copyright, which is very important. See, most of the time, one issue of the academic institutions I have already discussed, which is about joint authorship or ownership. See, in the case of copyright, authorship and ownership becomes very interesting because copyright authorship is completely different from copyright ownership. In the case of copyright, you see, authorship lies with the person who creates the work. He may not be necessarily an owner of that work by purview of the law. Law by purview of Section 17 of the Copyright Act says that generally the author is the first owner of the copyright. But this particular provision called Section 17 of the Copyright has a long list of exceptions. It says that if it is a work created by an employee under the employment, then the employer shall be the owner. It says that if it is a work created by an intern under the apprenticeship, that the in that case, the person giving the internship to that person, the employer, I mean, will be the owner. So on and so forth. I mean, there are ownership parameters under the copyright law which makes authorship different completely. I might have created the work. Say I am a employee of, it is not about the academic institution. Say I am an employee at a newspaper house and I come up with a report, right? That report is undoubtedly original report created by me or an editorial piece written by me. I might not get the ownership on that. I am an author because I have created it. But the employer shall be the owner in that case. Because copyright, is clear, is candid. Under Section 17, it is written that ownership lies with the employer, with the person who has commissioned you the work. And in the university systems, you know, we had faced several such challenges, especially the challenges relating to the creations of the newspaper, you know, the question papers. The challenges that we face in the universities in commissioning the work of question papers to the teachers of the universities or outsourcing the work of creating the questions paper to other university teachers or other university professors. Let me tell you that if somebody in the university creates a question paper, since question paper also requires creativity, And it was a question, you know, at that point in time when there arose this controversy back in 1918 in Oxford University in the Western world, where, you know, they faced this critical question whether the question papers or the questions set out by the teachers of the universities in the question papers are copyrightable or not. Undoubtedly, they are copyrightable because they are original works of the authors or of the creators. It requires application of mind, it requires your skill, it requires labor. So why can't there be a copyright protection on the questions set out by us? But the question when it comes to when it comes to the question of ownership of those question or you may say the ownership of the copyright on those questions, then the policy of the university has to be seen. If the university says that any work created by the teachers of the universities, especially as commissioned by the university, if the university has commissioned you to create a question paper for a class A, then that belongs to the university if there is a clear policy available. But if there is no clear policy available, then in that case it is problematic scenario that who will be gonna the owner of that work. In the absence of any such policy, the person who has created it, I mean the author, he will be the owner as well as the author. But if there is an policy available, then the university might retain the ownership with itself. And if the work has been commissioned, say a work has been commissioned to the outsider or to the professor of another university, which is usually done in the universities, then who will own the copyright on those questions which are set out by that professor who is an outsider? He is not an employee of your university. So for this, the answer is clear as given by courts in certain cases. The court says that if the university has not come out with the clear terms while assigning this work to that professor, then the professor will own the authorship as well as the ownership. But if the university, while assigning it, has clearly written it that the ownership will lie with the university, then university will keep the copyright protection. So let me tell you frankly that the works which are done under the contract of service, right, are, you know, enjoying the ownership by the person who is giving that contract. But the works which are done under the contract for service, these are the two arrangements which are generally done. Technical arrangements, or you may say legal arrangements, which are done. Contract for service. Say, I have been contacted by Vishwa Bharati University for my services in particular concern, say in the case of creating a question paper of IPR. So this is an arrangement which is contract for service, right? It is not a contract of service arrangement where you see employer and employee. I am not an employee of Vishwa Bharati. I am an employee of Delhi University. So in the later case where I am an employee of the Delhi University or it is a contract for service, my services are availed for only one particular work, the copyright shall lie with me in that case. But if there is a contrary arrangement in the assignment given to me or commissioned to me, which requires the ownership to go to the Vishwa Bharati University, then the copyright shall necessarily or should necessarily lie with the Vishwa Bharati University, notwithstanding that I am from a Delhi University who has created this work or who has authored this work. So this is one issue. Then coming to the library resources which we have in the libraries, especially the textbooks. All of you must have heard, especially the library people must have heard about the Delhi University photocopying case, wherein it was decided that there should not be any quantitative analysis or quantitative parameter in copying the work in the course of instructions by the teachers and by the people of the university. It's completely up to the university as to what has been instructed in the course of instruction by the university and how much work has been copied by the teachers and the students of that university for reading that work, for understanding that work. There is no quantitative obstruction or quantitative hindrance, as has been made clear by DU photocopying case, though that question of copying entire test book was not finally concluded by the Delhi High Court in this case, and there did not arise any later review or appeal in the Supreme Court of this case. But whatever was done by the division bench of this case, and later on the publishers in that case who filed this case against the Delhi University and Rameshwari photocopying shop, they backed out. They did not pursue it further because of best reasons known to them. But the point is that our law is categorically clear that copying or for in the course of instruction, if any work is copied by the teacher and by the pupil of the university, and in the course of instruction spends across the entire year or during the entire semester, it does not have a specified time, say 3 months or 2 months, when the actual teaching continues. It is something which spans across the entire year, where we have to prepare ourselves as teachers for our upcoming sessions, where the students are needed to be given certain readings even after the session is concluded for their preparation of their exams. So the session or the semester spans entire year. So the in the course of instruction means, as interpreted by the court in this case, means the entire year. So any copying done to whatever extent, because there is no quantitative obstruction or quantitative rider in the clause in section 52 1I, which I am referring to, of the Copyright Act 1956, which was also invoked in this case to exempt copying done in the universities by the teachers and by the students in the course of instructions. So this issue is categorically clear post this judgment of Delhi High Court, which is operative in the country now, because there is no other judgment of any other High Court which is hampering us as university teachers or as university students in copying the material to whatever extent. Even the entire book can be copied. Ethically saying or ideally saying, the entire book must not be allowed to be copied, but the law is there which allows the entire book to be copied if it is in the course of instruction. So the law has to be respected and it has to be upholded. I can't do anything, or idealism can't work here, right? So from the point of view of the author or from the point of view of the owner of the work, if I think, I see that my work must not be copied fully. If somebody needs in the course of instruction, say one paper or one chapter of my book only, to that extent he should be allowed. But the law says if you want to copy the entire book, you can go ahead with it. Even the law, the case law in that regard says so. So these are some issues, in the copyright we face in the academic institutions, which I believe are to be taken note of, are to be kind of dealt with very appropriately. Then one more issue is coming to my mind. We use these plagiarism softwares, for example, Turnitin or other such similar softwares, which are for checking the similarity. Mind it, there is an issue here which I want to quickly summarize and discuss. I believe that these softwares are helpful in finding out the similarity, but when it comes to plagiarism, which is an academic wrong, different from a copyright, right? But it is a subspecies of a copyright, undoubtedly. I believe that plagiarism can't be judged by similarity check. It has to be judged manually by the supervisor concerned by referring to the text which is in question manually, because you at times maybe the similarity of one particular content is less than 10% or 5%, right? But when it comes to its plagiarism, it may turn out to be plagiarized work altogether. Let me tell you how. I mean, some even if somebody has taken an idea from some reading or something and he has replicated that idea in his writing, even that is plagiarism, broadly speaking. So manually it needs to be checked by the supervisor concerned, and he needs to be well-read person to spot that kind of a plagiarism. Otherwise, we have these objective measures, like we have softwares available to check this similarity, wherein in universities we have somewhere we have 10% similarity which we allow for the submission, somewhere we have 20%. So these parameters are university made parameters. The parameters are not generally legislative parameters. No quantitative parameter is being imposed on the universities by the legislation in this regard. So with this note, I would like to conclude on time, and I open the floor for the questions.
So thank you very much, Dr. Sival. It's a very nice, informative and illuminating lecture, and also made us aware of, most of us become aware about these IP rights and how the laws and legislation is there to protect our such intellectual rights. Now it is open for the question answer. I think my colleague will take care about this question answer session, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a very informative and elaborated presentation on the topic. Creative work gives events pleasure, no matter how small it is. So this awareness on the intellectual property is highly appreciated. We have seen in the chat box a lot of appreciation has come. So
thank you very much for encouraging remarks. There were certain questions also, I believe.
Yes, sir. Yeah. One question has come from Aman Kumar. He is asking whether adding any engineering components to speed up the performance, will it come under patent or not?
Engineer component in speed up the work?
Yes, sir.
So it depends, Mr. Raman, it depends, whether the invention in question actually gets benefited by adding those features in it. And it is also to be seen, whether it is just an incremental, or a cosmetic kind of, addition in it, or it has actually brought some efficacy or you may say some, enhancement in the efficacy in that work. If it has bring some enhancement in the efficacy of that machine or an apparatus, then it will get the patent protection. There's no denial of it. But if it has been just a cosmetic or a workshop kind of a change or a feature added in the apparatus or a machine, then I am worried that it will get a patent protection.
Thank you, sir, for your answer. Your queries have been satisfied. One more question has come from Padmani Balaram. She is a professor of Shulpa Shodhan. She has asked, she said that one product may need 20 patents. So, and the charge for filing one patent may be rupees 70,000. So is there any way to reduce the cost?
See, individual patents needs to be, the law says that There has to be individual applications for each patent and claim, right? You apply for all patents created by you separately. You can't club those patents unless the patents have, you know, some relationship or some bearing with one another. Otherwise, you have to file separately and pay separately the requisite fee of the patent office. There are some options available for university and for, you know, startups, etc., or the schemes of the government are available for funding or for, you know, for facilitating you to file internationally. In the case of one scheme of the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technologies, which says that you know, if you want to file abroad any computer related invention, then they perhaps fund you for 15 lakh rupees. But it depends. I mean, there are certain qualifications to be met by you. Only then you will be able to avail those kinds of benefits.
Thank you, sir. One
otherwise, second. You have to file separately, and a separate fee has to be paid. And there is one more, you know, mode. If you are a public institution and if you are, you know, filing for a patent, you may go through patent facilitating centers of Department of Science and Technology. They you know, they help you in patent search, they help you in drafting, they help you in making your claim robust. So you must consult the patent facilitating centers of the Department of Science and Technologies of your respective state.
Thank you, sir. One more question has come from Devashish Datta. He has said that he has a collection of poems, so he want to know whether how to get the copyright for those things.
Collection of coins can not be given a copyright protection because it is not a subject matter of copyright protection. Rather, it is not a subject matter of any of the kinds of intellectual property. It is your hobby to collect the coins and you keep them with you, right? You show to your next generations, you may sell them, but you can't get a copyright protection on the collection of coins because it is something that does not require your creativity. You might have been given by your ancestors, you might have found those coins. It is not work that gets the intellectual property protection.
One more question has come from Shashank Shekhar Bhattacharji from Assam. Mm-hmm. He's saying, in case of a composition by a band, after a few months or something, there is a split of members. So how this, if any one member have, whether they have the right for this lyric or song,
Will you please repeat this because I find it really very interesting question, but I got distracted. Can you please repeat it quickly?
Yes, why not? A composition made by a band.
Band.
Okay. Yes. So the members split up. Now any one member can have the right.
No.
So the lyric or song.
See, if the composition has been created by all of them, then yes, all of them will be entitled to get the copyright. Since they have split up now, so in that case, if one individual goes with the copyright or claims to be owning the copyright protection on that composition, then it will be problematic because others will raise their voice and they'll say that we had also contributed. So it is not a work which is purely created by this ex-gentleman, right? So in that case, you know, he has to first enter into some sort of arrangement with them wherein he is ready to share the offshoots of that particular composition with them, or where he is allowed by them to go ahead with it. But still, let me tell you frankly, even that arrangement or that kind of a bargain arranged by you or attained by you will not be of any help in case if tomorrow they want to file a copyright suit against you. You may think that they have allowed you, right, and they will not raise an issue, and you will procure this agreement generated between you and them later on to defend yourself. But mind it, the law does not recognize that kind of arrangement. Law says that if the work is created by all of them, then all of them will get the copyright protection. Not only one individual, irrespective of any arrangement between them.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Madhusudan has asked whether if there is any software for the researcher.
Softwares are there, you know, for patent search. There are some freely available softwares. You may refer to WIPO's open access, you know, patent search, which is available to anyone. WIPO open search, you may, you know, go ahead with. It is open access, you know, platform. Apart from that, there are paid, you know, platforms for the patent search, which are available at the end of the universities, at the end of the patent facilitating centers, which are really very expensive. So open search has certain limitations. They are not all encompassing platforms, but WIPOs, as I mentioned, is one platform. WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization's platform, is one which is quite exhaustive. So you may refer to that.
So one more question has come from Devashish Sarkar. Mm-hmm. He is asking whether any song which are inspired by the Western music, whether it comes under the plagiarism or not.
Inspired, what do you mean by inspired? The inspired, the term inspired is you know, very problematic here. You, if you had just taken an inspiration and created something new, original means it has a modicum of creativity in it, then it's fine. But if your inspiration is such where you had just completely copied someone's work, then you may be booked for a copyright violation. So it depends what kind of inspiration you have you know, received from listening that song and from hearing that song. So my point that I want to tell you is that if your work is such which is not a substantial copy,
mm-hmm.
then you may be, you know, happily go ahead with the copyright claim. Otherwise, it will be problematic.
So one more question is there from Shubhadeep Das. He is asking the scope of intellectual property in the field of music research and music production. What should be the outlook of an artist in this regard?
The outlook of the artist in this regard should be to create new compositions, taking great care of existing compositions, and taking great care that he does not embark on copying someone else's work in that artistic feat or in this artistic endeavor. Because nowadays, you know, this industry of creating music and artistic works is very lucrative. We all see that every second day new copyright violation suits are being filed. And in from your state only, we recently had a problem against this rapper called Badshah.
That yes.
Wherein this song, which is very popular now, mm-hmm. was found out to have been copied, right? Or some of the portions of that song were found out to be copied. But though the issue was settled by paying some monetary compensation or amount to the, you know, creator of those lyrics or those that music. So you need to be very careful while your artistic feats or endeavors in the artistic environment.
So there's one more question from Dipali Kumar, Dr. Dipali Kumar. How to make patent in history?
ये question मैंने पढ़ा लेकिन मैं इसको explain करवाना चाहता हूँ. I want her to explain it. What does she want to ask actually? Because that question is not making any sense. Is she willing to ask how to get a patent on history? Patent नहीं मिलेगा history पे. You won't get any patent on history because patents are available on products and processes, on new inventions. Patents are not available on history or on literary works. If you have authored a book on history, you may get a copyright protection on that book, but you will not get a patent protection on that book.
So can we move to the next question? One more question is from Bhavnesh. How the patent is granted in par with international context for new invented device?
International context. See, there is a route called PCT route or Patent Cooperation Treaty route, which is a friendly route, or you may say which facilitates the inventors to file internationally in one go. And we are the signatory of this Patent Cooperation Treaty. It allows the domestic inventors to file internationally by paying the requisite fees. And this Patent Cooperation Treaty was brought forth for the purpose of facilitating the inventors to file internationally without manually going to or without physically going to other jurisdictions, without physically, you see, roping in the patent agents in other jurisdictions. What used to be the scenario earlier, before this PCT, you know, people used to go to the different jurisdictions physically, or sometimes they used to, you see, collaborate with the patent agents of those jurisdictions, have to, you know, keep the patent attorney paid. So it was a cumbersome job, or, you know, it used to be a very difficult task to file patent in different jurisdictions or different locations. But now with the PCT applications, we file it in different jurisdictions by just naming those territories into our patent application and by paying the requisite fee. And from that day itself, when you file the patent through PCT route, your patent application is deemed to have been filed in those jurisdictions also. So you get the priority over other patent applicants from the date you file the patent application in your country. I hope it answers your questions well.
So one more interesting question. Hope you have, we are not taking enough time of yours.
Haanji, quickly puche, no issue.
So Anurag Pandey is asking whether a researcher can ensure, how as a researcher can ensure that we are not violating the intellectual property right of the indigenous communities we are taking data from.
See, we have, in the case of indigenous communities, really don't have an all-encompassing database of their works, right, or of their creative works, creative expressions. But for, at least for biodiversity, which belongs to these tribal people and which they own, or, you know, and especially the outcomes of the biodiversity resources that they own, say a pharmaceutical, you know, treatment that they have by referring to the certain, or by taking due to certain biodiversity, you know, resources, those are, you know, available in the National Biodiversity Authority library, or you may say there is one particular organization or establishment which keeps a record of all the, you know, biodiversity resources of these people and otherwise, right? So any researcher who tomorrow refers to any such thing which is a biodiversity resource, then he will certainly need to deposit that biodiversity resource to the depository, right, to that library or depository, which is perhaps based in Chandigarh, I guess, for this region in north part, right, which is established in Chandigarh in north region. So one has to deposit any foreign, you know, say foreign innovator, he takes a biodiversity resource or biological resource from our nation, there is a requirement of law that he needs to deposit it first with the biodiversity authority. If he does not take the approval and he does not deposit, then he can be held liable for violation, right? So through that indirect way, you see, we have a record of biological resources. But when it comes to other creative expressions of these indigenous communities or tribal communities in India, we really don't have one set of, you know, one particular organization or establishment keeping record of their knowledge. But let me tell you that the patent law, speaking through one particular clause of section 3, says that any invention as claimed by you that it is an invention, if it is found a traditional knowledge, then it can't be given a patent protection. That will never be called an invention because it is a traditional knowledge. So if the indigenous community will tomorrow prove that this particular invention or a claim made by that X person, you know, it's a knowledge which we have been using from times immemorial, which is a traditional knowledge lying with us, then, you know, that particular patent will be invalidated. Even if it has been granted, then that can be invalidated. Or if it is in the process of the grant, then a opposition can be filed against that patent.
That will be infringement.
Yes.
So one more question from Padmani Balaram of Shilpa Sadan. She is asking, for any product design, can copyright for the new design and logo of the company be copyrighted automatically on the day of creation, or how to make it clear which day it was created?
See, for that you have to lay the evidence which day it was created. You have to produce the evidence And another thing is that for logo or for a design, you and if you are using that logo or a design in the course of trade with certain goods or services, then you will go for the trademark protection. You will not go for the copyright protection. Though copyright protection is available on these things because these things are artistic works, right? So both the kinds of intellectual properties can be conferred on this particular particular work, right? Which is what a logo or you know say a flag or something like that, right? As asked by this gentleman. But as I said, that you should go with the trademark protection because it is used, that logo or you know that particular device is used in the course of trade for selling certain goods or services, for making those services available. You can also apply claim for the copyright protection. You can claim for the copyright protection that these are your works, these are artists. But it has to be proved that these artistic creations are original artistic creations created by you. As far as the date is concerned, then evidence has to be led that you created these on that date, right? And the opposite party may come up with their date and certain evidences, ancillary evidences to prove that they were first in time vis-a-vis to you. So it is a battle. So it is advised that if you have something, you know, to claim for copyright protection, and if you get it registered, then evidentiary value ho jata hai aapke copyright certificate ka. Ye na pehle copyright ho gaya hai. That's how you know copyright registration is beneficial. Otherwise, copyright registration is not that necessary.
So one more interesting question from Saurav Mahato. He is asking if in the interview of the PhD admission, a student present the research proposal, and if later his or her ideas are used by someone who got listen the proposal, so how can these research scholar protect their ideas?
See, ideas are protected under the patent law. If he presented it in front of you, see some people used it later, undoubtedly he can stop or injunct them to make use of his ideas. The law is categorically clear that if your work is such which has been anticipated by you in public, this is a work which has been anticipated by you during your research presentation, you had not made it public where there was a entire university listening you, or a paper was presented in a big conference. You made your work public to a specified set of people where there were certain external examiners, where there were learned people present there. In that case, you can sue the person for the patent infringement, or you can inject that person from using your ideas, though you have not got the patent protection in that case. But still, if your ideas are such which are worthy of getting a patent protection, you can sue them. But it depends, because it is an open question. It is not a final or concluded one. I can't even, I can't answer it in a concluding manner or in an exhaustive manner. It depends in how and in what manner that idea or that information has been used. If that information or an idea has been used just for, you see, getting inspired and, creating a new work altogether, then it's fine. But if that work has been as such replicated or, has been imitated completely and fully, creating a work over which a later patent is obtained or claimed, then you may object that it is your idea which you presented in the August forum somewhere, and he had taken a cue because he was a presenter. You may oppose that person's patent application on this ground. It can become a ground for patent opposition as well as a ground for patent revocation if the patent has been conferred with.
So the questions are keep on coming. So
I believe we must stop now.
So can we have one more question?
Yes, last question.
This is from the Faculty of Social Work. Nilmani Jaiswal has asked, for how many years copyright of published manuscript lies with its primary author?
It lies for lifetime plus 60 years. During the lifetime of the author plus 60 years after the death of the author. the legal heirs of the author can enjoy the copyright protection on that. And it varies from work to work in the case of copyright. But in most of the cases, it is lifetime plus 50 years, right? It varies. I mean, in certain cases, it is lifetime plus 70 years. In certain cases, it is lifetime plus 50 years. In certain cases, it is lifetime plus 60 years. But undoubtedly, lifetime plus 50 years is the minimum, you see, tenure or minimum term.
Thank you, sir, for it.
What are thanks to the minute?
Who did you? Apni Dhimil. Apni Dhimil, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Please go.
So, I think that we came to the end of this webinar session. So now, this is the time has come to just give a word of thanks to all the
Achha.
So now time has come to give the word of thanks to all of you. Now, first of all, I would like to thank our inaugural speech given by Dr. Pratibha Singh. I thank you very much to participate in this seminar and this webinar. And also, I want to thank Dr. Oshini Siwal for his exhaustive and illuminative lecture, and finally answering the several questions that would help them to just find that making them aware of these IP rights and laws. So it is all the way, it's a very nice session. And also I would like to mention that our Vice Chancellor has extended his support and encouragement. So I would like to thank him also. And finally, I would like to thank all the participants who actually made this session successful. And that is why this has become a very nice session indeed. So thank you all. Okay.
Thank you very much, sir, for inviting me for this talk. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.